Доброго дня, шановні колеги. Для нас є велика радість і честь бачити і вітати вас в Верховній Раді України.
Dear colleagues, it's a very great honor and pleasure for us to welcome you to the Верховна Рада of Ukraine.
Я хочу поінформувати вас, що сьогодні в нашій зустрічі також беруть участь голова нашої делегації міжпарламентської в парламентській асамблеї ОБСЄ Артур Герасимов, що свідчить про дуже високу зацікавленість міжпарламентського діалогу в контексті ОБСЄ.
I would like to inform you that in our today's meeting, the head of our delegation in OSCE Parliamentary Assembly, Mr. Artur Gerashenko, participates, which testifies the high level and high interest of interparliamentary cooperation within the OSCE.
І, по суті, керівник комітету євроінтеграції Марія Іонова, з якою ми щодва тижні буваємо на Донбасі. Марія, вона ще займається не лише євроінтеграцією, а інтеграцією Донбаса до також до Європи, реінтеграцією Донбаса до Європи. Тому це дуже важливо.
And also Mrs. Maria Ionova, who is actually the head of the Committee on European Integration, participates here. And we, together with Mrs. Ionova, every week visit Donbas region. So she is engaged not only in European integration of Ukraine, but in reintegration of Donbas region into European community.
Дозвольте розпочати нашу зустріч із спільної позиції Верховної Ради України щодо засудження всіх фактів агресії відносно місії СММ ОБСЄ. Ми не приймаємо і засуджуємо будь-які факти недопуску місії ОБСЄ до місця проведення роботи, хто б це не робив. І ми дуже жорстко засуджуємо і висловлюємо співчуття відносно загиблого спостерігача місії СММ ОБСЄ, а також факту сексуальних домагань, які були дозволені представниками незаконних озброєних формувань до жінки спостерігача. Це є неприпустимо.
And I would like to start our meeting with condemnation and with the common position, our common position on condemnation of all acts of violations of rights and of acts of violence against the representatives of OSCE, as well as we condemn all situations when the representatives of the missions of OSCE cannot reach the regions they want to reach, and we condemn that death of the representative of the mission of OSCE, as well as the sexual harassment of a woman representative of your mission.
Я хочу подякувати Німеччині і Франції, чиї уряди зробили дуже жорстку заяву щодо цього, і так само, як і український уряд. І нам здається, що все-таки в таких випадках уряди інших країн-членів ОБСЄ мають більш жорстко, публічно реагувати на такі факти. І також ми вважаємо, що в Мінській групі ми будемо дотискати представників ОРДО і ОРЛО провести всебічне розслідування щодо і факту загибелі, і факту сексуальних намагань, щоб були встановлені прізвища, щоб вони були покарані. І ми вважаємо, що цей випадок має стати таким спеціальним фактом прийняття резолюції на парламентській асамблеї ОБСЄ. Тут не може бути політики. Це спільне несприйняття агресії, жорстокості і несприйняття антигуманних методів.
We thank the government of Germany and France for making a very resolute statements on these cases, as well as by the Ukrainian government. And we think that we will, and we're sure that we will persuade and we will make pressure on the representatives of the Lugansk and Donetsk temporarily occupied territories within the Minsk group. We will make pressure on their representatives to investigate it in a full-fledged scale, to name the names and to make this public. And I think that this should be very resolute within the discussion of all the institutions, because there's no politics in it. And this is a very serious ground for the resolution to be passed during the next Parliamentary Assembly OSCE session.
Також дозвольте поінформувати вас, що в рамках парламенту діє неформальна мінська група, яка включає в себе представників всіх фракцій парламенту, і де після кожного мінського засідання ми інформуємо колег щодо тієї роботи, тієї позиції, що веде Україна. І також в рамках цієї мінської групи ми вже напрацювали ряд законопроєктів дуже важливих. Зокрема, це і законопроєкт на захист родин зниклих безвісти разом з Червоним Хрестом, а також вдосконалення українського законодавства, щоб допуск Червоного Хреста на всю територію України до пенітенціарних установ. І ми будемо, ми раді були там вітати пана Апакана, і ми дуже відкриті, щоб і всі країни, які є представниками, які є членами ОБСЄ, також могли там долучатися, дискутувати, тому що ми вважаємо, що це також важлива дискусія в контексті реінтеграції і інклюзивного діалогу щодо майбутнього Донбасу.
And I would like to inform you that we do have an informal so-called Minsk group within the Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine, which includes the representatives of all factions, and we, after each our visit of Minsk, we inform this group about all what we do and about all our agreements, and we have developed several draft laws within this group, which would include, for example, the protection of those who disappeared people, and for possibility of the mission to get access to all the points it needs, and I think and it is done within the Red Cross, and that I think that this allows to integrate and to gather all people who are interested in discussing these issues to discuss them within and you can anyone of you can join these discussions, and we were very lucky to welcome Mr. Apakan to the penitentiary institution. So we welcome you to participate in this discussion.
Щодо дискусії відносно МЕП по виконанню мінських угод, то я хочу чесно вам сказати, що український парламент тут стоїть на наступній позиції. Має бути пріоритетність виконання блоків мінських угод. Перше – це security, це очевидно. Друге – це не політичний. Політичний, гуманітарний блок. Тому що доки сьогодні на окупованій території знаходиться 128 заручників, доки ми констатуємо недопуск місії Червоного Хреста до пошуку зниклих безвісти, а в нас їх більше 400, ніколи український парламент не сформулює політичну позицію, коли щодня депутати отримують від родичів заручників, від родичів загиблих ці емоційні такі заяви, ми не зможемо наблизитися до просування тих ключових позицій щодо політичного блоку. Тому ми стоїмо на такій першочерговості – безпековий, гуманітарний і потім політичний блок. І я запевняю вас, що в парламенті ми знайдемо порозуміння щодо політичного блоку, якщо буде виконуватися безпековий і гуманітарний. Це дуже важливо.
And concerning the implementation of Minsk agreement, I would like to inform you that we give some priorities to first to security block and then to humanitarian block, because until we have 128 hostages on the territories of Donbas region and Lugansk region, and until we have cases when the Red Cross do not have access to the investigation about the 400 disappeared people, it will be very difficult to find consensus within the Verkhovna Rada on a political block of the Minsk agreement. So I can assure you that we stand on the position that if the first, the security, the second, the humanitarian block are fully fulfilled, then we will find consensus and we will find forces within the Rada to fulfill the political block.
Я хочу звернути вашу увагу на ще один дуже важливий момент того, що відбувається на Донбасі, це екологічні ризики. На жаль, за 3 роки війни саме екологічний аспект набуває нового звучання, і ми маємо сьогодні ризики екологічної техногенної катастрофи на території, що постраждала від конфлікту. Це і затоплені шахти на окупованій території, куди не допускають німецьких експертів щодо для проведення експертизи. Це підприємства в сірій зоні, які потребують ремонту, і ми не отримуємо дозволу на режим тиші для того, щоб провести цей ремонт. Це Донецька фільтрувальна станція. І, власне, нам здається, що сьогодні особливим об'єктом уваги, в тому числі спостерігачів СММ ОБСЄ, мають бути саме ці екологічні об'єкти, які потребують особливого моніторингу і спостереження.
There is one more factor I would like to inform you on. This is the ecologic risks we do have on the Donbas territory. After 3 years of war, we have the situation of ecological catastrophe on that territory. It concerns the flooded mines where the German experts have no access to in order to make their expertise, to give their expertise on those mines. It also concerns the enterprises in so-called gray zone where we need to make repair and restoration, and of course we cannot gain the ceasefire regime in order to make that repair.
Ну і наостанок, на для нашої моєї вступної промови, я хочу також акцентувати увагу в цій дружній аудиторії відносно того, що ми вважаємо, що необхідно, звичайно, вдосконалити моніторинг місії СММ ОБСЄ. Ми дуже дякуємо вам за вашу роботу. Ми дуже цінуємо ту підтримку, яку СММ ОБСЄ робить в процеси встановлення миру на окупованій території. Разом з тим, в суспільстві українському є великі запитання відносно того, чому сьогодні за ці 3 роки війни місія СММ ОБСЄ лише кілька разів була біля кордону. Чому не допускається до всієї окупованої території і, наприклад, закритим залишається Дебальцеве? Чому в звітах СММ ОБСЄ не вказується, коли саме запрошували допуск і хто саме не допустив? Чому насправді так само ми не боремося разом за допуск повністю на всій території окупованій. І особливу увагу, очевидно, потребують не лише екологічні об'єкти, а також КПВВ, які, на жаль, сьогодні так само стають об'єктами такої постійної атаки, там часто навіть виникають обстріли КПВВ. І українську позицію, ви знаєте, ми вважаємо, що біля КПВВ мають працювати спеціальні хаби СММ ОБСЄ, які мають працювати 24 години на добу і 7 днів на тиждень. Тому що це безпека цивільного населення.
Concerning the ecological situation, I think that it should be of deep and very attentive also regard towards these risks on the side of the, from the side of the OSCE mission in this friendly today room and in this friendly atmosphere, I would like also to stress and draw your attention to the fact that you should and we should make more active the activity of your monitoring mission because we appreciate greatly all work you are doing and all the work you've done already, but for today in Ukrainian society we have several queries, several requirements towards the mission's activity, which concerns, for example, why the mission didn't only twice has been at the border of Russia and Ukraine, for example, and why the mission doesn't have still the access, for example, to the Debaltseve, which is closed for us for today, why there is no information in the report of the mission about when you made the requirement for the access and who didn't give you that access, who denied it, We also should together work on getting access to all the points and to all the positions which are needed and which need your presence, the presence of the mission. Here we also speak not only about those objects of ecological disaster, but also about the points about the points about the checkpoints where the representatives of OSCE, I think, should be 24 hours, 7 days a week, as it goes about the security of civilians, of civil people.
Thank you very much for your support to Ukraine. Я на цьому ставлю крапку і хочу сказати, що тут всі розуміють англійську мову, тому ми будемо зосереджувати зараз на заощаджувати на часі для перекладачів. І я рада передати слово нашим колегам і партнерам.
Thank you very much. And here I will make a stop, and I can tell you that everybody here understands English, so we will save time on translation, and we will pay more attention to what you're going to say. So I give the floor to you, to our colleagues, please. Mr. Apakan, Mr. Clements.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Kharashchenko and Mrs. Yonova, for receiving such a group of OSCE ambassadors here in the Verkhovna Rada. It's a great honor for us, but I think it's also very important. It is of particular importance for us to hear also the views from Parliament on the current situation, not least because a great responsibility falls upon the Rada when it comes to the implementation of the Minsk agreements. Constitutional reform, decentralization, special status law, law on local elections in the Donbas. Minsk is strongly criticized from several sides within the Rada, yet this is so far the only way forward agreed upon by Russia and Ukraine towards a political solution. Minsk is not only about security along the contact line, but also about concrete political steps by Ukraine towards ultimately elections in the Donbas. We understand that these are controversial questions within the Ukrainian public. What role do you see for the members of parliament to improve the atmosphere in the country for the Minsk agreements? And as regards the negotiation in Minsk, we unfortunately have to note that a substantive discussion is more and more replaced by polemics between the sides, which is also directed against individual coordinators of the working groups. I would like to underline here that these coordinators have been appointed by the chair in office, and we expect that they receive the necessary respect by the sides in order to do their work. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Vice President. Thank you, members of parliament, to take a moment for all of us. We are 27 ambassadors making the this trip to Kiev today, and who have been very much willing to meet members of the parliament of the Rada. We came in Kiev and in this parliament with four messages. The first, our first message is our full commitment to contribute to the resolution of the crisis in Ukraine in compliance with the Helsinki principles and commitments. Our second message is the our support. We want to reiterate our support to the work that the SMM is carrying out in Ukraine, in the Donbas. After a death, the first death that we were all fearing it would happen at one stage, it did happen 1 month ago. And we are even more fearful for our observers that we put all in the field and who really risk their lives to contribute to the settlement of the crisis, to observe the ceasefire, to observe the withdrawal of weapons, to help implementation of humanitarian measures, to do everything. So these observers are the sign of our commitment, and we are here also to reiterate this commitment to the SMM, to thank Ambassador Apakan and his teams. Our third message is to check the humanitarian situation. People in Donbass are suffering. Children are not going to school. Elderly don't have the means to go to hospital, for example. So we want to have a message to the humanitarian organizations, to the civilian society, and meet also the international humanitarian organizations such as ICRC, UNHCR, OCHA, and ECHO. And then our last message, Ambassador Clemens Koya, representing the chairmanship of the OSCE, mentioned that we all want 27 ambassadors here to reiterate that the Minsk package is the only and unique roadmap for the settlement of the crisis. And we count on you, members of the Rada, we count on you, representatives of the people of Ukraine, to help us help you solve this crisis. We need your commitment. We are doing our utmost with our diplomatic means, but we count on you with your parliamentary means to move things forward. Thank you very much.
Дуже дякую, шановні колеги. Дозвольте коротку ремарку і обмін думками потім. Шановний пане Клеменс, я дуже дякую вам за те, що ви наголосили на відповідальності парламенту за політичну частину, зокрема за конституційну реформу, децентралізацію. Я б ще додала сюди амністію.
I would like to make a short remark and after that the exchange of views. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Clemens, for reminding that this is the Verkhovna Rada who is responsible for political aspect of the agreements. And you mentioned the constitutional reform, the decentralization, and I would add here the amnesty to this.
І я хочу нагадати вам, що Верховна Рада України ще у вересні 2014 року проголосувала і амністію, і також конституційні зміни, також підкріпили це потім в серпні 2015-го, а також у 2015-му в березні ми проголосували дуже важливий закон про особливості місцевого самоврядування на території Ордо-РЛО. Але ці закони не вступили в силу через псевдовибори, які там були ініційовані, по суті, інспіровані Кремлем, а зараз це дуже сильно ускладнюється через, по суті, рейдерське захоплення українських підприємств і визнання документів Російською Федерацією цих псевдореспублік. Тому для України є дуже принциповим так само позиція тут всієї спільноти ОБСЄ відносно того, що мають бути скасовані як ці результати псевдовиборів, скасовані всі ці псевдоінституції і, звичайно, указ Російської Федерації, керівництва щодо визнання документів. Тому що це все допомагає нам просунутися політично. А свою відповідальність ми знаємо, і амністія вступить в силу відразу після безпекового блоку, після гуманітарного блоку, і тоді, коли на окупованих територіях з'явиться український суд, який веде амністію, проводить її.
And in this context, I would like to remind you about very important decisions which was adopted by the Verkhovna Rada in September 2014 concerning the amnesty. We adopted and voted for that decision, and we also voted for the constitutional changes to the constitution, and we once again voted for that in August 2015, and I would like to remind you about a very important legislation which we adopted in March 2015 concerning some peculiarities of self-governance on the territory of Lugansk and Donetsk region, that legislation didn't came into force because of those pseudo elections which were held on the territories of Donetsk and Lugansk region, which were inspired and supported by Kremlin. And for now, in the situation when we have the seizure of Ukrainian enterprises on those territories, the situation is even more tough because all these things hinder us from gaining the consensus on the political issues. We do understand our liability for political bloc, and I can assure you that the political bloc will and the amnesty will come into force as soon as the Ukrainian court will appear at the territories of the Donbas and Lugansk region.
І зараз я хочу дати коротке слово моїм колегам Марії і Артуру, які ну дуже серйозно опікуються, зокрема, і темами Донбасу. До речі, Артур з Донецька. Це зараз по суті IDPs у нас в парламенті. От і так само спілкуються дуже серйозно з в рамках парламентської асамблеї ОБСЄ.
And right now I would like to give floor to my colleagues, to Mrs. Ionova, to Mr. Artur, whose family is from Donetsk, actually, so he is a kind of IDP person here within the parliament, and they are all, they are too very much engaged in all the issues concerning Donbas and concerning the communication with the OSCE.
Thank you very much, dear colleagues. First of all, I want to say real big thank you for your visit here, because we are really very open. And I'm always, even during the international conferences, my all international meetings, I'm inviting people, because after you will see everything personally, in person, yeah, it will be much easier for you to understand why we are so worried about international situations. Because what I understand really very well, because chain about Ukraine didn't start in Ukraine, because what Putin is doing in Ukraine, in Crimea, started in Pridnestrovia, in Georgia, in Chechnya, and only after they didn't receive prompt response, they understood, by their way, that maybe it's allowed. And that's why it's really very important now to, you know, to provide this response for their actions, because otherwise it will be just a question of time and question who will be the next, because unfortunately they are doing this. Just several words about SMM. I want to support my colleagues, and I want to prove that in all our negotiations, in all our actions, we are saying two very simple things. First one, SMM monitors are heroes. I met with them many times, and Mr. Arpakan knows that I am always proving that, because I understand. Many times I was in the line, and I understand what they are really feeling on that territory, what they are feeling on the occupied territory. So we are really understood that you are doing that, but want we really kindly asking you to increase any efforts from your side with purpose to protect monitors. Because for me, this attack on SMM during which US monitor died and two others were wounded, it's, I think, an attempt from Russia to do it. And after again, they're waiting, what will be the reaction? It will be allowed or not, because they, you know, like doing some experiments and after waiting for the response from the OSCE states. Next point, I really want to stress your attention, it's the control of the Russian-Ukrainian border, I mean uncontrolled part of this border. This is the key. And believe me, if the uncontrolled part of Russian-Ukrainian border will be closed, approximately in several weeks, everything will be almost finished. Why? Because every night these guys delivering ammunition, forces, tanks, artillery, and that's why Russia is strongly against any kind of control. And in the beginning, we can start this control maybe not by physical presence of the OSCE monitors, because Russia will be strongly against that, but by control of technical, you know, equipment. I mean, UAV or some web cameras. Now we fortunately have 21st century, and I think it will really will be helpful for the downing the level of ceasefire violations from their side. Next point I want to stress your attention is Crimea. Because, you know, of course, at the moment we are speaking widely on Donbas. We are speaking, you will visit Donbas tomorrow. But SMM mandate is covering all the territory of Ukraine, and we are really worried about human rights violation in Crimea. And if Russia is so open, why they closed Crimea for almost all, you mean, humanitarian organizations, and first of all to the OSCE, OSCE SMM monitoring mission. Let's force Russia to open Crimea to the monitoring mission, because it's really very important. And you know, human rights violation and also militarization, huge militarization of Crimea. Because what they did initially, they restored, and this is very dangerous, all the places for keeping nuclear weapons. This is the proved facts. If they are not going to use nuclear weapons in Crimea, why they restored all the, you know, premises, all the locations in Balaclava and other regions for related to this issue? And now more and more we are receiving information. And it's very, very dangerous, because even high-level people from Russian Federation starting openly to speak about nuclear weapons in Crimea. That's a very dangerous fact. Next point, peacekeeping operation in Donbas. We know, and I exactly remember how, you know, hard talks we had and have, still have on this issue, but it's also can be really very helpful in stopping war very quickly, because Ukraine and all of us very, very interested to stop this aggression. And Russia use any, you know, small possibility to continue it, because they are interested in that. And some comments of those things I saw from you during your speeches now. First of all, Rada is always keeping Russian aggression in Donbas in our focus. And we always keeping in our focus the social issues, as Irina Yurashenko told you. And just small example, just a couple of weeks ago, we adopted the draft law, now it's a law, about help to the children from the occupied territory to get education in Ukraine with the easier procedures, without many, you know, procedural things. Next point, about constitutional changes. I still remember the, you know, situation in parliament in the August 2015, and all of us were believing that time that after we adopted it, yeah, everything will be go much quicker. I mean, ceasefire, withdraw the weapons. And what we did in the parliament, we did beforehand, let's say, before schedule, these constitutional changes. It was extremely hard because, you know, people died in the center of Kyiv that time. It was a huge, you know, battle, but we did it. August, nothing. September, nothing. October, nothing. And now in the parliament, you know, many people are asking that we did it. No reactions. What more? And last but not least, just 10 seconds. You know, I'm really very want to say again thank you for the monitors and tell about behavior of Russian forces on the occupied territory. Recently in Mayorsk, it's, you know, gray zone, we decided to reconstruct the roofs because people asked us, and we started these operations about reconstruction of the roofs in the five-level building. Immediately after we started it, snipers from the occupied territory started to attack our constructors. That's what the how they, you know, thinking about our support of the people and how they are against supporting the people. So that's briefly. In case you will have any questions, I'm ready to answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now Maria Ionova. 3 minutes, please.
Okay. Your Excellencies, first of all, I really thank you that you are going to Donbas, because as a representative of the Committee on European Integration, we're also organizing visits with the EU MPs and other European politicians to Donbas area, that, you know, to more, for more understanding in realizing that this aggression is not in Ukraine, this aggression is in Europe. And I would like to say that we're really very concerned also on that we are not able altogether to unblock the humanitarian access to occupied territory. And we kindly ask you to be also more public in such statements, because we know the situation on medicine, on like old people, so on their rights on occupied territory. Also, we really condemn that your technical equipment is also has harassment, and we really think that it's such a violation. It's also one of the pressure of Russian Federation, you know, to fright observers of SCE. Also, I would like to say that we are really, really concerned about the situation in Avdiivka and Krasnogorivka. You know that the Grad shellings increased for last 3 weeks, and we have more civilian wounded, injured people, especially in Avdiivka. As you know, for like 40 years, two women, one man, and one boy who is 23 years old was killed, and two girls, 4 and 6 years now, are without parents. So we really are worried about such aggression on civilian population. Of course, the numbers of wounded soldiers are much more. Also, I would like to say that we, in the parliament, we are working on the bill, civilian demining, and we will adopt it next parliament plenary session. So we were working hardly on this bill, and I hope we will adopt it soon. Regarding peacekeeping mission, really, it's a solution. It's not only a solution for Ukraine, it's a solution for the whole European region. And as my colleagues mentioned, it really takes time, just probably 1 month, 2 months, to demilitarize this occupied territory when we will close the border. So we kindly ask you to pay attention on the Russian-Ukrainian border, how we can close it. Regarding also, I would like to say ecological problems. It's really a new challenge. And we are also going as a committee to organize such joint committees, ecological and European integration in the Donbas area. Because, you know, the infrastructure, it's a common. It's like from Ukrainian territorial control and occupied, it's our citizen on that territory. And that is why we're really worried that we even are not able to repair the common system, because it's also not about people who are on controlled territory, it's also about our citizens on occupied territory. That is why we kindly ask you to pay attention, you know, to have this permission, not to, like ceasefire, to repair all this infrastructure objects. So we really thank you so much that you are visiting Donbas, and we are always ready to answer all your questions, and we really hope that Minsk agreement will be implemented, not only and there, because they're implemented now by Ukraine, but also by Russian Federation. So we are absolutely obvious, but that only Russian Federation are not implementing. So we have to find the ways to press Russian Federation to implement Minsk agreement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Шановні колеги, якщо є запитання або бажання також висловити позицію, нам це дуже цікаво.
Thank you very much, and if you have any questions or if you wish to make your position, so you're welcome to do that.
Будь ласка.
Thank you, Adam Bugajski, ambassador of Poland. To OSCE and UN in Vienna. Thank you for this opportunity. And let me also express support for Ukraine sovereignty and territorial integrity. We repeat this line every week during permanent council meetings, as the EU is very important. So thank you also for your work towards the implementation of the Minsk agreements and towards the resolution of the conflict, because you are subject of an external aggression, so it's quite clear for us. A question about public opinion, public attitude towards Minsk agreements. What messages are you getting from your voters, from the Ukrainian people? I think it's very important in order to maintain a level of support among people to the implementation of the agreement. Thank you.
Я буду абсолютно з вами відвертою. Нас не можна сказати, що Мінські угоди сприймаються суспільством як ідеальні, і це є правда.
I would be very frank with you that the society doesn't accept Minsk agreements as ideal ones. This is the truth.
Навпаки, вони сприймаються і суспільством, і політикам дуже важко, і небагато є захисників Мінських угод серед українського політикуму.
On the contrary, they are accepted and perceived in a very controversial way, and we do not have much advocates for the Minsk agreements.
Найбільш болючою для українського суспільства є той пункт Мінських угод, що кордон передається українським прикордонникам наступного дня після виборів. І це є та позиція, яка сприймалася дуже великою частиною суспільства, як навіть певна зрада. І нам дуже важко дається позиція, пояснення, що ми дуже чітко, українська влада, стоїмо на наступному. Вже сьогодні, зараз. Контроль має перейти також під спостереження наших друзів, партнерів місії СММ ОБСЄ, що сприятиме демілітаризації, деокупації і поверненню законності на ці території.
The most painful point in this agreement and statement for our society and for our politicians as well is that we should gain control over our border after the elections are conducted. It was even perceived as a kind of a betrayal on the part of our citizens. This is very hard for us but we are doing our best to explain people that we stand firm today on the point that the control over the border should be submitted to the representatives of our friends, of our partners, of the mission of SMM, which will provide the demilitarization and the occupation of those territories bringing back the legal Ukrainian law to those territories.
Знаєте, тут сидять люди, які бувають на похоронах наших військових. І це дуже важко пояснювати мамі чи дружині молодого загиблого хлопця, коли вона кричить над труною, і запитує, а де ж ці ваші Мінські угоди? Чому вбили мого сина? А що це не Мінські угоди вбивають хлопців наших, а тільки цього року вбили 98 українських солдатів. А вбивають їх незаконні збройні формування з незаконної зброї. Це дуже важко пояснювати.
Always meet people who are present when our soldiers are buried, and it is very hard to explain to the mother who is yelling under her son why and asking where are your Minsk agreements, why doesn't they work, and why my son is killed why they are not working, this is very hard to explain that these are not the Minsk agreements which kill their son, and we have only 98 soldiers were killed only during this year, they are killed by the illegally armed forces. But this is hard to explain that thing to the mothers.
Але це дуже велика і важлива робота пояснювати, що Мінські угоди зупинили гарячу фазу конфлікту, що ми працюємо над деескалацією. І, власне, ми віддані, от, політична сила президента, більшість, українські дипломати, ми, звичайно, віддані політико-дипломатичному шляху врегулювання Мінських угод. Ми дуже наполегливо працюємо, в тому числі і по роз'ясненню населення щодо тієї політики, яку впроваджує українська влада, для того, щоб мир повернувся на Донбас.
But this is very important mission to explain to people about the need of implementation of Minsk agreement, and we explain them that Minsk agreement allowed us to stop the escalation of the conflict in Donbas region, and where it works for the de-escalation of the situation, and we, the political force of presidential political bloc and political party, are very much committed to, and our diplomats as well, are very much committed to political and diplomatic settlement of the and implementation of Minsk agreement.
Ну, звичайно, ми будемо відвертими. А дуже часто виникають і в українських військових, і в цивільного населення і питання відносно місії самим ОБСЄ.
And we will be frank that very often we have questions on the part of our soldiers about the activity of the OSCE mission.
А чому місія закінчує роботу о 5-й годині? Чому місія не бачить дуже часто тих обстрілів, які ведуться по цивільним пунктам? От сьогодні я отримала таку інформацію, я не знаю, наскільки вона правдива, але я хочу вам про це сказати від журналістів, які знали, що буде така зустріч у нас. А вони надіслали фотографію, начебто, я не знаю, чи правда це, але хочу до вас апелювати, щоб ви її перевірили, що начебто керівник Донецького обласного офісу спостерігачів СММ ОБСЄ Ольга Скриповська стоїть на параді, який відбувається в окупованому Донецьку, з георгіївською стрічкою. Якщо це правда, це, звичайно, неприпустимі речі.
We will be very frank about that. Soldiers sometimes ask us, and very often ask us, about the activity and the work of your mission. First of all, why your mission stops its work at 5 o'clock, for example, or why it doesn't see some shootings, some shelling of civilian points and civilian territories. And I would like to say you here that this information is not proved and is not I don't know whether it is true or not, but today our journalist who knew that we will have such meeting sent me a photo where the head of your mission in
Донецька СММ АБСЄ в Донецькій області.
The head of SMM in Donetsk region, Olga Skripovska, is maybe it's not true, but she stands at the parade in the Donetsk region with Georgi, like Georgievska, I don't know how to say that, symbol, with the symbol
which
like
forbidden.
Which is forbidden, and we should. I would ask you to check if this is the truth.
Наша позиція є наступна. Ми усвідомлюємо, що в місії СММ ОБСЄ працюють цивільні, що це не озброєні люди. Ми усвідомлюємо, що задача української влади так само є безпека місії СММ ОБСЄ. Але ми наполягаємо на тому, що і на окупованій території мають гарантуватися доступ і безпека місії СММ ОБСЄ. Ми дякуємо вам за вашу роботу, ми дуже це цінуємо, ми це доносимо українському суспільству. В той же час ми очікуємо все-таки і дуже вашої такої поглибленості встановлення миру на Донбасі. Ми щиро усвідомлюємо ті ризики, які стоять перед вашою місією, але і також розуміємо, що ваша місія є дуже важливою для дуже чіткої фіксації і встановлення миру.
And we realize that the members of your mission are civilians, they are not armed people. We do realize all the risks and the need of support of Ukrainian authorities for the security of the representatives of your mission. But at the same time, we would like to have for your representatives to have access and to have security to as much objects, as much territories, as many territories as possible. And we, of course, deliver the message of the importance of your mission to our society. Trust us, we tell them that your mission is very important and very much needed. And we thank you for all the all work which is done by your mission, but at the same time we would like you to like a kind of go deeper into all you can do in order to make the peacekeeping process as close as possible.
Excuse me, just two points. I would like to pay also your attention on our very painful issue, humanitarian hostages, yes? Because unfortunately, also in a society, I mean, the relatives, the moms, the wives of our military and also civilian who are hostages in occupied territory in Donbas and also in Russian Federation, but it's so it's also unfortunately no solving, yeah, it's blocked. And Ukraine, I mean, Irina can tell you more detail how hard she works in contact groups in Minsk, that Ukraine has made a lot of compromise, you know, to get our Ukrainian citizens back. And the problem is that sometimes also, I mean, it's my experience when I hear in European capitals that hostages are from both sides. No, in Ukrainian territory, we have people who has made heavy crimes and they are under investigation. And on the occupied territory, this is hostages who are more than 3 years not to any convention in what conditions they are. You know that they don't have an access, that they don't have advocates, that they sometimes they are in the shellings, they are not even like fresh air, and they don't have, of course, an access of international organization. Because when we were visiting these people on controlled territory during winter, I mean, who are now detained because they were violated Ukrainian law, warm conditions, five-time food, relatives, letters, contacts, advocates, and just by accident, we have met a few persons from International Red Cross. So, and that is why we kindly ask you to pay attention to our hostages in occupied territory, and it's a separate question, that hostages what we have in Russian Federation and, of course, in Crimea. The problem is that in Crimea and in Russian Federation, Ukrainian citizens, it's just like a hunting. So this is a really a problem for the whole society. How can we deal with this challenge? Thank you.
If I may, Mrs. Chairman, we'll have to leave in a few minutes. We've heard what you had to share with us, and we are very grateful for having shared your views. But I think some of our colleagues would like to take the floor and give their views as well. It's very important that you hear them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for meeting us. I'm the British ambassador to the OSCE. Just briefly, if I can very quick try and do two quick questions. Firstly, Mrs. Garashenko, you mentioned some of the restrictions on the SMM, and you also refer to some criticism of the SMM. Ambassadors around this table, probably nobody is more concerned than we are about the restrictions and intimidation of the SMM, so we totally share that. But I'd be interested to know how well you think the purpose and the mandate of the SMM is understood, both within the RADA and also within public. And then if there's time, Mr. Hramasimov, you talked about the need to protect the SMM better. And I just would be interested to... Did I understand rightly? I think you said we needed to protect the SMM better. I'd be interested to know you think how we could do that.
Can I interrupt you? And maybe we could, just for the sake of time, and maybe Frédéric, and then we'll have to wrap up. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm the ambassador of Sweden to the OSCE, Frédéric Lequist. Thank you very much for receiving us here. This trip, of course, takes place against the background of the worst violations of the OSCE principles. And we were also here in this room in 2014. We are here to support and find a sustainable resolution of this conflict, and a sustainable resolution can only be in line with the OSCE principles and commitments, and we have to direct our efforts in restoring the territorial and integrity and sovereignty of Ukraine and Ukraine's choice to choose its own foreign security policy. There are two things that you mentioned, and of course that also includes Crimea, as you rightly mentioned. There are two things that you mentioned that I would just pick up and to hear a little bit more detailed your thoughts about. The one thing is on how can we induce Russia, so to say, to come back to restoring these principles also underlying the European security order? What can the OSCE or the international community do more in this case? You also mentioned here repeatedly the idea of a peacekeeping operation. Your thoughts would be appreciated a little bit on more in detail what possibly a peacekeeping operation could do, at what stage, where, and when, and at what for what purpose. Thank you.
I will provide the joint answer from all of us in English immediately. First of all, about protection of the SMM, yes. Because these guys are working on the very, very dangerous environment. What does it mean, protection? First of all, to use more technical things. Technical things, this is the first element of protection because, you know, it's for me a common. And the second one, protection by organizing the joint pressure to the Russian Federation. As I told you, this explosion, I strongly believe this is what it was planned, and this is attempt. This is like experiment from the Russian Federation that they are waiting now for the reaction. And believe me, if will not be the reaction, prompt reaction, it will be the second, third, fourth accident, unfortunately. Because Russia doesn't understand, not Russia, Kremlin doesn't understand the language of normal conversation. They only understand the language of power. The second issue about Crimea. You know, at the moment, Crimea is totally closed. And I think how to push Russia to open Crimea, it's only, again, unfortunately, the language of power. What does it mean? Sanctions. I understand that maybe many of us are speaking and maybe we will communicate with them, maybe we will speak with them. But at the moment, 3 years of aggression, and what we have, we are speaking with them, and what they are doing on their own way. And again, let me one more time stress your attention. It didn't start in Ukraine. It started in Chechnya, no reaction, in Pridnestrovia, no reaction, in Georgia, no reaction. The guy now understands, wow, it's working. Why not? Now, if they will receive reaction, believe me, it will be stopped. And the last but not least, about peacekeeping operation. I think I understand the system of the OSCE that Russia can block whatever they want. But I strongly believe that if we will continue jointly to, you know, keep our stress or keep, you know, our push on Russian Federation, they will do these things. Because their actions at the moment against the common sense. Because when we are proposing peacekeeping operation, we want to stop the aggression, we want to stop the war. When we are proposing to close the border, we are proposing to stop the war, and they are strongly against. That's an idea about, you know, these questions you asked.
Dear colleague, thank you very much. Mr. Apakan, it's very important, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I have to say that Rada has been always very helpful to us in endorsing our mandate and keeping an eye on us. with regard to our safety and security. And we have been, the Honorable Deputy Speaker and her friends were personally taking care of us. Of course, we are trying to deliver the maximum we do on the front line. And I have to say that even today, we have nearly 360, 400 monitors through with patrols of 50, 60 moving around the contact line. So this is not an easy job, and it's challenging in a cycle of violence in a changing environment. Of course, there are some areas which we couldn't able to monitor since the incident. But I have to assure you that the main bulk of our work is very much related to hotspots. And in those hotspots, we are covering almost every detail. Through technological instruments, and also by patrolling, even on foot. We are somewhat foot civilian soldiers taking care of the contact line. In that respect, I think this has been a useful discussion, and we are benefiting from this discussion. But since the Honorable, there has been a reference to our team leader in Donetsk, Olga, I have to bring a clarification. This news have been taken on the social media, and we issued on 13 May a fact sheet about the situation. The reality is, the photograph was taken in 2010 at a wreath-laying ceremony at the grave of an unknown soldier in Balti, Moldova, Olga from Moldova. The ceremony was an act of commemoration and remembrance of the sacrifice made by millions of men and women in the fight against fascism. And while the significance and symbolism of the ribbon may have altered since 2010, then, of course, it had no meaning other than the honor, the bravery of previous generation. And I think even in this part of the world, this is universally acknowledged. What I'm trying to say, this picture has nothing to do with the ceremony of Ordo in May. It has been taken in Moldova because she's a Moldovan soldier, a colonel in the army. And I have to say that I'm proud of her because she's working day and night, and she has one of the most difficult jobs in our team. By keeping, and I'm sure whenever you meet her, you will see her and Jerusalem to contribute to peace and normalization in Ukraine. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ми спеціально задали це питання без преси. Ми хочемо подякувати за цю відкриту дружню розмову, і ми дуже цінуємо цю можливість поспілкуватися. І зараз, як ви не проти, пропонуємо зробити фемілі фото на пам'ять для того, щоб також продовжити. Yeah. Ми відкриті дуже. Якщо будуть питання будь-які до нас в письмовому вигляді, ми завжди дуже раді на них відповісти. Дякую.
Thank you. We just put that question without press. On purpose, and if you would like, thank you for this frank and friendly conversation, and let us make a family picture, please, in order to continue. And if you have any questions in writing to us, so we are very open to give our answers.
на сходах.
Так, на сходах парламенту.
Добре.
Давай.
Дякую. Десь там буде.
Так, вибачте.
I was cutting my